nation itself, and what were some of the difficulties that we went through, but also more importantly, the impact after the nomination and what how we have actually leveraged on the nomination itself. Right. So just to go give you a little bit of a background, Singapore's golden cinema era started around about the early 1950s to the 1960s and into the early 1970s. And during this decade or two, we made about 300 Malay films. And the two major production houses were Cathay Keris and the Shaw Malay Film Productions. Cathay Keris made about 120 films, but only 91 titles have survived. And that resides with the AFA. We've been preserving this collection since 2007. And we were inscribed into the MOWCAP in 2014. Right? And what happened with this collection was that we were introduced to the film, the owner. Actually, it's, have you heard of the Cathay organization? They own a distribution company, you know, properties, and aside from many other malls and stuff. And the owner, the daughter, currently that's running the empire, had a very she was very possessive of the films that were in the collection. So Cathay organization made many Chinese titles, which she actually had already donated to the Hong Kong Film Archive. And this was way before AFA was formed. So when AFA was formed, she said, okay, the Malay classics actually belong to Singapore. She felt that it shouldn't be donated to any other archive aside from someone that would be able to take care of it in Singapore. So it showed that she really treasured the collection. And when we went to her warehouse, that was quite frightening because it was situated next to a carpentry shop. That was the amount of sawdust that you see floating in the air. You can actually see it like across, you know, a plume of sawdust. And when they opened up that particular store, it was stacked ceiling high, just like stacks and stacks of foam. And it was mixed, this collection was mixed in with current collections, you know, new films. So I said, where exactly is the collection that we're supposed to take? It's all just around, figure it out. So, okay, so we spent maybe about several months trying to pull films out and figure out which belongs to the original Cathay Keris collection and which didn't. And even then, we couldn't figure out if it was the full collection because we didn't know, and they didn't have an inventory of what each film had, how many reels they had, and in what format. So we knew that some came in 35mm, some came in 16, and some came in both 35 and 16, and some came with mags. So we just pulled everything that we could find, and I think in the end we had 785 reels, and they all ended up in the National Archives, and they gave National Archives of Singapore actually gave us a space to work from. And we didn't have any manpower at that time. It was just two of us. It was I had a staff and myself, and we looked at that. So we said, it's going to take us years to go through this. And finally, we said, no, we're just going to make an open call. And we got volunteers to come in. And so we screened four good volunteers that we thought, okay, we'll have the sustaining power to stay with us throughout to, you know, process this entire collection. And they did. And so we actually worked through the entire collection, and we threw out in the end 35 reels that were too deteriorated to even salvage. I mean, there was rock hard, some were like in liquid forms and so. But other than that, most survived. So what happened was that we decided around about 2012, I met Belle Kapoor, some of you may know her. And she said, you know, Karen, you should start thinking about, you know, submitting something to MOWCAP. And I said, what in the world is MOWCAP, right? And then, you know, so she sent me all this literature and stuff, and I, okay, I had to read through it. And I said, okay, I'll think about it, but I was personally quite daunted by the amount of literature that I had to go through. And because I was alone at the time, I said, I'm going to shelve it for a while. And in 2013, I met up with Ray at some, I think it was a CPOP conference somewhere. And I said, Ray, I'm a bit scared to start on this, but if I don't get started, I'll never do it. So Ray said, you know, never mind, just read this bit. And so she sent me a book. And so I read through it and I decided, okay, I think it's doable. I just need to find people that can help me, right? But I needed to figure out within 4AFA, what exactly are we trying to nominate? You know, what is so significant about this collection? I had to figure it out myself, because if I can convince myself, how can I convince anybody else? And I had to figure out why we wanted to do this and then later on how. So these were some of the questions that I struggled with, and we came up to this. At this point, the research and documentation was the most daunting, because I needed to find some justification to write out why I was nominating this collection, but also to find enough information about the collection, because the Malay classics in general is not greatly documented, neither is it a great research topic. And aside from Singapore and maybe some Malaysian academia, we actually don't have a lot of material on it. And so I thought, okay, the way to do this might be to speak to some academics who were working on the Malay collection, and they pointed me to, you know, different literature reading material and stuff. And then I also needed to figure out what are we going to do in terms of finding resources to support our claim, something that we could present for assessment, because everything was in the prints. What could I look at? And then, of course, we needed to clear this with the copyright owners. And this is the part where yesterday we talked about commercial films, right? And what exactly, you know, would their response be? And you know what they said? They said, if it doesn't cost me anything, if you are going to do all the work, I don't quite care. And besides, it gives me some, you know, a little bit of glory. I get a bit of name in, you know, somewhere. If people suddenly know more about the films, why not? And the only thing they said was, you know, just keep us posted. And if it goes into the press, keep us posted. Right. So I said, okay, fine, very good. And then it came down to looking at the form itself. But prior to that, as I plowed through the form, I think if you remember yesterday when you did your exercise, for this particular collection, the most difficult was section 5, which was looking at the selection criteria, looking at the authenticity, the world significance, and how you compare it against the various criteria of time, space, people, subject, theme, form, you know, that kind of stuff, and also looking at the other matters. So this particular section took me a particularly long time to sort of navigate through, and I wanted to just show you the components that I wrote on this, because I think it's quite vital that when you're working on it later, so this is the section, and I went through, at this point in time, I had acquired a very large collection of film memorabilia from a collector in Singapore. And from his collection, I found, hey, there's so much material to look at in terms of posters, magazines, all kinds of lobby cards, different sorts of write-ups about the films of the time, but they were all written in Malay. And right at that round about that time, I also discovered that actually the National Library has a huge collection of posters and magazines and lots of things that actually refer to the films of this particular collection. So I thought, okay, this is where we'll start. I wanted to go through it and to see if I could actually find somewhere in there to authenticate the fact that this collection, or at least to express it in words, right? Because I've seen the thing, I know that it exists, but how do I convince somebody who hasn't seen the films, and obviously that the committee of MOWCAP, that this is indeed something that is unique. And so it was something that you actually have to think through be able to put it out in words to convince someone else, right? So that to me was what I thought needed to be done quite succinctly, because we don't have a lot of space. But you need to pick things that you could show and things that you could write about to give examples of this particular whatever that you're trying to indicate in that nomination form. And then so this item on world significance, I wanted to show how there was a great deal of collaboration between Singapore filmmakers and the directors with India, the Philippines, with Malaysia, obviously from the region. There was a Japanese collaboration. There were people who were working on the films in different components of the production. And it showed how much of the industry was really embedded within this region. And even though the films, in terms of its quality, in terms of its production value, isn't the highest, it really indicated that it was part of the culture and heritage of the region. And people who would watch it would actually be able to identify with it, right? And not just in terms of its production, but also in terms of its music, the dancers in it, and of course the landscape that has changed so much. And I think that's something that I keyed on, you know, sort of latched onto and expressed in the elaboration. Okay, and I also showed how I took this particular example of a current visual artist in Singapore who then went on to take the films, the Malay films, as his inspiration to talk about life and art. And it showed how much the film actually sort of could be of an influence to a current and young artist of his stature. And this artist has gone on to won a lot of awards, you know, in the Biennales and everything. So it really indicated a certain significance of the collection in itself, just because it's being utilized by young and upcoming artists as well as filmmakers, right? So I also, and then of course this component which goes into the various criteria of time, space, place, and all. This particular one, I wanted to show how it was important in its particular time, right? So looking at it now, people may laugh at how, you know, silly the site, special effects, because there's a particular film called Pontiana about a female vampire, and it comes from legend, folklore, Malay folklore. And I wanted to show how much that legend and that folklore has lived on through time, and the films speak for that, right? And I wanted to show how it was also the first time that you're putting that legend into film, into something visual. And much as we laugh at how silly they look now, it continues to scare people, right? It continues to intrigue and to fascinate your mind as what exactly is our culture talking about when we talk about the Pontiana, right? And then, of course, this component on space, because the Cathay Keris company was actually based in the eastern part of Singapore that now has become a residential area. And so what's interesting about it is that all the streets there were named after the films. Yeah, so it just shows how significant the films were, because people, you know, and I recently did a little documentary on TV, and I brought my son along because this area was where his kindergarten is, and or was then. And the film showed how the area has changed from the 50s till now. And we walked through a particular street, and I was telling my son in the documentary that this particular street name is named after a film from the Cathay Keris Collection that MOWCAP's company is preserving. And it just shows how much what we're doing actually lives on for another generation. Because he suddenly was saying, ah, now I remember you telling me many years ago and showing me a photograph of the films and relating it to the street name itself. So it brought him from something so conceptual to a visual and then to the actual space itself. You know, so it's really quite a step, I think.
Is there a street name for Jana?
For Pontiana? No, I don't think anybody would want to understand Jalan Pontiana or something. It would be scary as hell. But what is interesting was that...
It's a city.
It's a city, yes. That's true. But I also pointed out that in the films, because they always have these frangipani trees in the film, and this entire area is filled with frangipani trees. And we were talking about how, you know, the legend goes that every time you smell the scent of the frangipani in the evening, that's when you start going home because the Pontiana will be out roaming the street. So this is really interesting, like how you, and this is exactly that, I mean, you know, trying to find something that people could relate to. So this was is actually a map of the actual space and all the different street names. And you can see, you know, there is, I think, let me try up this so you can. Okay, you can see this, look at that, Jalan Keris is here. Jalan Saudaraku, the name of the film is Saudaraku. Jalan Buloh Perindo. Buloh Perindo was the first color film, Malay film. And then there is, let me see. And this entire area is called Keris Drive, right? And so what's interesting is that the place here where, I don't know if you can see it, oh, it doesn't. But on the right-hand side, oh no, sorry, it's here. Ocean Park is actually now a condominium. But Ocean Park was actually built, before that, it was the Ocean Park Hotel. And Ocean Park Hotel was owned by Cathay organization. So what they did was they used the hotel as a film location, filming location, right? So in the film, in many of the films, you actually see the actual hotel being utilized and the entire area being seen in the film itself, and you can actually see the streets and the landscape within the films. So at that time, I think they used a lot of location filming. Okay, and then of course the people. I wanted to show how there were so many actors and actresses and even directors that became famous or even known for their work because of the various films. And I made some highlights of different people who are still alive. Wahid Sate is still alive, and he actually came. He was known as the Jerry Lewis of Singapore because he could make these really funny, expressions and really good voice imitations. And I'll show you a film later, a clip that he starred in. And then, of course, some of these key players of that generation, this very famous lady who was the actress who acted as Pontiana. Yeah, so she's Maria Minardo, and she went on to be one of the first few female, actresses who later on also opened her own film company. So it's quite a feat for her at that time in the 1960s. And of course, Zubir Said, who not only composed many of the films in many of the songs in the film, he was also Singapore's composer of our national anthem. So it's very significant people that that came out of the film collection itself. Okay, and there was some subject and theme. I didn't know how to fill this up. I actually left it blank. I submitted it blank because this entire collection is a feature film with all kinds of representing all kinds of subject matter. I didn't quite know how we could actually, you know, encapsulate that. So, I mean, it's, so it's possible to actually leave some elements blank. Yeah. Okay, and then in terms of its rarity and integrity, I, you know, wanted to just show that we don't, there were no other copies of these films anywhere else, because we, and we knew that because the owner made sure of that. And so we, I actually told her, ask her, are you very sure that you don't have any other copies anywhere? And she said, I'm positive, because I'm very, she was very insistent that everything had to be kept with her. And so she was only willing to let it go because it was coming to an archive. Okay, so, you know, items like the fact whether it's a threat, well, it is, given that you're holding it in a warehouse next to a, you know, carpentry shop with everything else flying around. So, you know, these were the parts that were relatively easy to kind of reply in that sense. Okay, so now comes what happened after the inscription was successful. So we were all very happy. But what we weren't prepared for was the impact of it. Right after it, it was announced to us that, you know, you've got a successful inscription, the Straits Times, which is our local newspaper, covered it in, I think it was a week after the news came out. So in 2014, we had this particular coverage, and then on Channel News Asia, which is online, but then I was also interviewed on a live Singapore Tonight, Channel News Asia, and they covered why it was important to this. We spoke about that on the 10 o'clock news. And then it was covered in the Malay newspapers. And these were all the different times in which we were interviewed live for different TV sections. Right. Okay, so initially we said, okay, good, we had it all covered. How is it going to, you know, continue, or will it continue? How are we going to do this? And this was some of the impact that we got, and I will explain to you how it actually worked. So we got the government aware of this, and with different, in different sort of ways, and I'll explain that a bit. The stakeholders, obviously, Cathay organization was very happy. Oh, you know, it's gotten recognized, and that people were getting wind of the fact that the collection actually existed, and that we were going to be making it available at some point to the public. And we also started to get a lot of researchers, film researchers as well as academic researchers, who say, when are these films going to be ready? You know, like, how can I see them, right? So the first thing we did was that right after, so that was 2014. In 2015, that would have been Singapore's 50th anniversary. So we figured, this might be a good time. And so we went to the Singapore Film Commission, and we said, you know, we have these films, would you like to work with us on something? And they said, well, what exactly did you have in mind? I said, if you have money, we will restore a number of films, and you can get to show it at, you know, SG50. So SG50 was something that was going to be a year-long, you know, extravaganza. And they said, actually, that's not a bad idea. Let's have a spotlight on Singapore cinema. We'll give you, I think they gave us enough money to restore three films. And you can imagine the amount, right? So it is not a small sum. And it's so hard to get money from the government for these kinds of projects. And the fact that they did, we said, we'll do, you know, what we can. And so I picked up three titles that would be of significance, but not only that, that were of, that were the most deteriorated, so that we could actually save them, but utilize the amount to actually showcase how important it was to actually restore or preserve the funds and then restore it for, you know, future use. So it got and to Capitol Theater, and the result of it was some things like these, right? And so these were actually painted, hand-painted posters by a surviving cinema billboard artist. Yeah, so we got him to paint on oil, so the oil paintings, and he made different, I think, of the five films that we screened that night, he painted one for every film. And this particular film, for instance, Lion City, is the only only Chinese film that was made by Cathay Keris. Right, so it was very significant, and so we picked up these things that were in the collection and screened it for at Capitol. And the theater was packed, I mean, like, you know, just people coming to watch them, right? So it was reported in papers. Okay, but out of it came an opportunity to actually make a little documentary which the government paid for, to showcase and highlight the work of the archive. And they actually sent, they said, okay, pick a staff. We want you to bring the camera crew to the restoration lab. And at the time, it was going to Italy for a restoration at Ritrovada. And so Ti Bao had the opportunity to go to Bologna and actually work through with the crew and with the lab as to the various stages, and we could actually produce not just a TV documentary documenting the entire process of the restoration, but out of it came an educational clip that we could actually use for schools, we could use for all kinds of different things, and we managed to make clips of it, little trailers that we could use for you know, things that we showcased outside our office, at the Capitol Theater itself, things like that. And so just show you a very short excerpt from the documentary. So yeah, that was part of the documentary. Okay, then after that came 2016, and we had the chance to work with the National Arts Council because they were saying, we're looking for a project. You guys have anything that you want to work on? And they said, yeah, actually, we have this in a collection and we wanted to showcase it. But because it's with the Arts Council, they were saying that you need to incorporate art somehow into this particular project. So came State of Motion, and this is what we developed. We want to just have a look at and pass it on. So what happened was that we developed a project that would bring people on a bus tour or bus tours to film locations that we identified in the films, and they would go there and they would see an artwork that has been commissioned by a young artist who had watched the film and was then inspired to sort of develop his artwork or her artwork based on the location as well. So it became a combination of film and art coming together in the entire project. Okay, so all right. So this is how we plotted the different sort of tour routes that would bring people to different tour locations, including Cathay Keris, Jalan Keris Estate, that was part of the tour. Okay, and then of course we created an exhibition on the Cathay Keris films that showed the various locations of the films, in the films. And well, I'm going to show you one particular section of it and the film that we then tagged to it, and you can see how it actually works. So we called this the unsettlings of the land, because at that point in time in the 60s, that was when the reclamation of Singapore was starting, so they were reclaiming a lot of land. And a lot of our coastline was disappearing, islands were disappearing, but we had newfound lands, right? So this was actually part of the dumping ground of Kallang Basin just before the reclamation itself. And this scene was actually in one of the films, and this the bottom picture is what the island actually looks like now. Okay, it's actually what we call Frog Island or Pulau Serkadu. It's off Chek Jawa. It's a sort of a small island in Singapore, and you can see how much of the land has, you know, sort of disappeared from the film and versus current day. And of course, on the left is actually the start of the reclamation project in an area called East Coast. And on the right picture there that you see is actually the entire area here, this land area, is being sort of reclaimed. Okay, so I'm going to show you a film called Mak Tidak Suku. And it shows that plot of land, that actual plot of land that was being reclaimed and that had already been reclaimed actually. So you're going to see. And this was a piece of artwork that the contemporary artist made in the jungle. This area is now what sort of is the reclaimed land that you see in the film. So it's become sort of like this disused, unused jungle area. And the artist then built a bus stop, but the bus stop is rooted to the ground, right? So it's made of cement. And so people who came for the tour started to just sit on the bus stop, take pictures, you know, they put on Instagram and blah, blah, blah. But it created the buzz for the film, and so people started, I want to watch Mak Tidak Suku, right? Like, it's so funny, and like, what exactly is the film about, and all that. Yeah, so it was a very cool project. Okay, so overall impact since December 2014, we've restored 5 Cathay Keris film titles with subtitle 10, and we've digitized 15, and we're hoping to do a lot more this year because I think it's slated to, we've managed to get some funding to subtitle another 25. And digitize close to 20 more titles. And we are also restoring another 2 Cathay Keris titles this year. Yes, and this is a clip from Gado Gado. The actor in it, the lead actor, is the actor that, the guy that I was telling you, Wahid Sati, who is still alive. And this film made it to the, what is that? Restoration festival called in Bologna?
Cinema.
Yes. And so this was our first entry and it got accepted. So I guess just to sum it up all, it's just the fact that we really did make use of the nomination, and it has helped the collection a lot and helped AFA put our work into the spotlight. So, yeah. Do you have any questions? I could actually. Any questions there? Okay, yeah.
When you make a screening on Terminal D, did they make a chance?
Did it what, sorry?
You sell the ticket.
Okay. Those tickets were not for sale. They were given out free. Because the government, because it was funded through public funds, it would not have been right to charge, and so we actually made that free for all. Yeah. In fact, quite a lot of the screenings we actually made it free. There were some screenings, for instance, that we did. I think we did for our anniversary. If you see at the back, we have those little postcards. That particular film we made free. For our anniversary, and then subsequently we charge some for ticket prices and people pay to come. Yeah, so it actually, you know, the multiplying effect is there. Yeah.
P. Ramlee up for Cathay Keris?
Sorry?
P. Ramlee?
No, P. Ramlee is under Shaw.
Shaw.
Yes, yeah. So
that's... The big stars here were Menadu.
So that would have been Mara Manado, I would have been, you know, Wahid Sate, that would have been the big directors like Hussein Hanif, who did all these films that were very epic. Because Cathay Keris, sort of their style is to do very epic films that were based on historical events as well as legends and folklore. Whereas Shaw Brothers, their style was to go with a more contemporary sort of you know, soap opera kind of style. So that was P. Ramlee's.
Are there would you know whether the Shaw films are also being preserved or any concern?
Yes, very good question, because we've approached the Shaw Brothers and they, for some reason, are very hesitant. Mm-hmm. But I suspect a lot of the films are lost.
Oh.
Yeah. They do have them on Digibeta in terms of a copy each of the titles that they have in the collection, but they are rented out to whoever wants to screen them. So they use those copies as rented copies, and that's it. Yeah, so I'm actually very worried for their collection, and this year is sort of like a reach out year to that again. This would probably be our fourth or fifth time approaching them since the Cathay Keris collection has come in. So, because they're two rival houses, right?
Yes, yeah.
We've been trying to use that a little bit, but I think the mentality for Shaw organization is that they're more concerned with their current operations than anything of the past, which is okay, fine. You're a distribution company. That's what you're concerned with. But it puzzles me a little bit as to, because their heritage, they don't seem quite to be as concerned. They have a huge collection of Chinese films as well, and that has already been sold off to Celestial, which is a private distribution company. So they have no hold, no rights to any of their Chinese films, and the Malay films are still under them. It's just that I think they don't actually have a lot of original material left. Yeah.
But they're being preserved. Would you know?
They're not being preserved.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So it's something that we're trying to reach out to them this year. And we'll see what happens. So hopefully we have good news, because part of State of Motion for 2018 is to feature, or at least the plan is to feature Shaw films. And hopefully, because we're going to be featuring them, they will be willing to take the plunge to preserve their films with us. So it's just some motivation that it's going to lead on to something else. Because they allowed us to restore one film as a result of SG50. And it's a very early P. Ramlee film. But it was so bad, in such bad condition. Even after restoration, you really can see the effects of time on that film. And so people were saying, oh my goodness, this is restored. Imagine what it was like before. You really could not make out anything. And the image, the mold had just like ripped up portions, parts of their faces, and it's all like, even after restoration, it's all blurry. The front and the back has they've lost it. Things like that. So we're hoping that it would sort of sit with them somewhere, that they need to take some action.
So, last thing, we're representing Southeast Asia, and can you tell us about your program to collect the films from the region? I know you've got films
yes,
in the Philippines.
That's right.
So is that an active program that you do within the region, and how can we sort of, what the other countries could connect?
It is an active thing. So we do have films from the different countries, and largely, for these collections are the ones that either didn't get archived within your own country, or that the filmmakers came to us and said, we want you to preserve them. So what we've done is that these particular collections, we're working with the filmmakers or the rights owners to actually catalog and make them available, right? But more importantly, things that we needed to work on. So I'm sure you've heard that we're working on Mike Gideon's Batch 81. So hopefully that film will be ready for screening, and it will travel back to the Philippines for its premiere. and also to make that sort of internationally, so we want the film to travel. So that's part of what we're doing. But I think other than that, we're also working with different institutions, you know, in your countries to find things that may be missing. So for instance, a project that we did was called Celluloid for the Lost Films of Southeast Asia. And that's where I think Nick, you also helped KB on some of the material. I think Sophie, even Dev, I think, they all contributed bits of information, and I know Thai Film Archive did, on things that are lost and that you have remnants of, and then we actually pulled together an exhibition to showcase that here in this building. So, you know, people were actually introduced to all the lost cinema of our region that, you know, that people should, you know, be aware of. And we made an open call, and unfortunately we haven't heard back on anything. But we've managed to get paraphernalia of things that, you know, people came through and said, oh, I have, as a result of seeing these things, you know, I have this other collection, would you like it? You know, I have these other things that, you know, came up as a result of whatever. And so there were benefits out of all these other projects. Yeah. I mean, I think if you have ideas as to how you think we should work together, always open to, yeah, because all the merrier, you know, for us to be able to collaborate.